Welcome to Local Spotlight on Grand County TV18. I'm Jerry Nissen, and I'm here today with Clark Lipscomb from Grand Park. And Clark has been the face of Grand Park, the whole development here in the Fraser Valley. And Clark, as with most development, there's been some controversy about this. The rec center in particular was a real hot button item for people. Once it got going, once it's been in, all the critics seem to have died down. Everybody seems to love it now. How do you feel the rec center has really affected our community?
Well, I think the rec center has been a life changer for a lot of people in the community. In particular, families with children and giving them stuff to do when the weather's inclement or otherwise. And I know a lot of older people use it. The silver sneaker programs, things like that. I really think it gave us a lot of alternative recreation, and we have fabulous outdoor recreation, but we didn't really have anywhere for indoor recreation when the weather isn't perfect outside.
And it's not always perfect here, as we know.
No, it's not.
Clark, the rec center is adjacent to your Grand Park property, and there's some great amenities that you've got there now with the liquor store and the foundry. What else is coming there in the future?
Well, we're working on two new commercial buildings now. Those buildings are in the design phase, and we're in the bidding process on them. And they're intended to be primarily restaurants, bars, shops, entertainment type businesses. And they're designed in a very traditional format. I think they're going to fit in nicely, and they go between the existing general store building and the bowling alley theater. That's the initial phase of the village expansion from where we are today.
Where is it going next?
Well, the full build out of the village is intended to encompass about 13 buildings in total. And we'll have residential condos over commercial. But the intent is to have a very recreation-oriented, entertainment-oriented, I call it the get-together spot, to park your car and stroll around and decide where you want to eat, what smells good, what do you want to do for entertainment. That's what it's all about.
So multiple choices, multiple restaurants, all of that.
Right.
Okay. Great. Most people in the Valley, I think, are familiar with you as being behind the development of Grand Park, but a lot of people aren't really aware of the charitable side of things, the foundation that you've created, mm-hmm. and the money that you give away in the Valley. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, when we started our project in 2004, we decided to create a foundation that was focused on the Upper Fraser Valley. We seeded that foundation with $500,000, and in perpetuity, it has a quarter of a point transfer fee from real estate sales, both in the Leland Creek development that we did and the Grand Park project. And traditionally, we give away about 5% of that principal amount every year. We've grown the principal amount to be greater today than that $500,000, while we've given away almost $250,000 in the last 8 years.
So who are some of the people that you've donated to over the years?
Oh gosh, it's a long list.
I mean, I know Lions Club is
the Lions Club would be one of them. Of course, we support the local Rotary Club as well. Many of the early education centers, the Early Learning Center, Grandkids, those are just to name a few. Gosh, off the top of my head, I can't. We support the concert series.
Grand County Concert Series,
Grand
the classical music
County concert series, yes. Mm-hmm. There's a host of them. Jerry the Graham Foundation, of course,
sure.
We give to as well. Try to cover the bases from a countywide perspective.
So you try and spread it around. You haven't just picked one or two favorites that you've supported. You've done lots of different things with it.
Oh, yeah. There's probably in excess of 50 different organizations that we've donated money to over that time frame. Yeah, and it's primarily focused on early education, social and recreational components, cultural components as well. And that's been a very good thing. So hopefully it'll continue to grow, and as we develop and sell more real estate, that begins to feed it in perpetuity, and the overall goal for that foundation is to grow it to be a substantially large foundation, being able to contribute meaningful amounts to really assist with some of these good causes in the community.
And because you have that 0.25%, I believe you said it was, transfer tax, that every time there's a real estate sale, it keeps replenishing the fund. That's where the money comes
from. That's right. It's a transfer fee. It's not a tax, but it's a fee. And and it's recurring revenue. So as things develop and sell, it continues to replenish. So hopefully we'll get to where we can give away more and more money every year and continue to grow the principal balance of that foundation.
Very good. It's good to keep the money in the valley.
It is. It's very nice to keep it in the valley.
Yeah. Now, besides Grand Park, what other projects do you have going on at this time?
Oh, gosh. Well, I have projects in Hawaii. One's called Kealiakai. Another one's Moloa Bay Ranch, and I'm involved in a ranch project as well there on the island of Kauai. And I have some commercial projects in Florida that I'm involved in the Palm Beach Gardens, West Palm Beach area. And there's some stuff in Colorado still, Chaparral and Aspen, Woody Creek area, some ranches in southern Colorado that I deal with and operate. And then our company's doing quite a bit in California now as well. So it's a pretty extensive list of projects that I deal with.
What else have you done in this valley? I know Grand Park is the big, most visible project, but I know there have been others as well.
Well, we were involved initially, we came here initially, in the Rendezvous project, and we were partners in Rendezvous. We decided it would be best to split things and move forward on parallel paths in 2004. So we were pretty heavily involved in the early stages of Rendezvous. We did the Leland Creek development that's in the town of Winter Park.
Yes.
In really 2005, 2006. That's been a very successful neighborhood, great neighborhood. And then Grand Park, and of course the Byers Peak Ranch that we're currently working on. And our core focus in this area will remain in the Upper Fraser Valley and primarily in the town of Fraser.
Now, Grand Park is built around a pretty big parcel of land. How large is it, and what other land do you have in the immediate area?
Well, Grand Park's about 1,300 acres in total. Adjacent to it is Byers Peak Ranch, which is approximately 300 acres. And that's it. That's what we have. So it's about, it's a little over 1,600 acres in total that we're working on right now. And it represents really all types of real estate, from developing a new commercial core to single family homes, single family lots, condominiums, townhomes, just about every type of real estate you can imagine is planned. Ultimately, it'll be a very long endeavor in our view. We're here for the long haul, have been here for the long haul, plan on being here for quite some time. In terms of developing that project.
We're going to take a brief break. We'll be back in just a couple of minutes with more about the future of Grand Park and Clark's vision for the Fraser Valley. Welcome back to Local Spotlight. I'm Jerry Nissen. I'm here today with Clark Lipscomb from Grand Park. Glad to have you with us, Clark.
Thank you for having me.
And while we were on break, you and I chatted a little bit about some of the stuff that's going on in Grand Park right now. You've got some homes under construction, and there's been some sales and some activity.
Yeah, no, things are going good. We had some leftover inventory that we sold out of this last year. And we're in the process now of building some new homes that we worked really hard on developing this new product, and they're going on quite well. We started with three. Two of those three are sold. We have some more solds that we're starting to build. My feelings are that product's really the right fit for that neighborhood and really focused on the amenities of that neighborhood and the experience. It's a great neighborhood, the Cousins Meadow neighborhood, and very social. That's one of our big social groups. Are mm-hmm. our neighbors. I live in that neighborhood.
Right, I know you do.
And lots of kids and mm-hmm. Some full-time residents as well, which is great. So it's coming along nicely. And then the Cousins Point project is another great project that has happened there in Grand Park. And that's a condominium project that Jerry Ashbach and Dan Guile have been developing. Right. And it's also coming along nicely. They've sold out and are in the process of getting ready to start another building, which is great.
Now, where is that exactly in relation to the rest of the things?
Well, the Cousins Meadow neighborhood is on the northern part of the meadow, and Cousins Point's right there next to it. So when we started out the project, we took a decision to work from existing infrastructure to the middle, try to build more critical mass, which is what we feel pretty strongly this valley needs, and then work right. our way up the mountain. And so the focus has clearly been on the meadow development. Mm-hmm. We put in some very nice amenities, which the whole community uses. It's become a very social place. Hiking, right. frisbee golf, cross-country skiing.
Sure.
Some very nice ponds that we developed. Lots of people walk their dogs out there, et cetera. So
right.
It's been fun. It's turned into be quite a nice amenity.
I know we've done like the doggy drag, for example. Grand County yeah. Pet Palace has done yeah. the doggy drag there. Didn't you have snowball
there over
the winter?
We did snowball this last winter. That was a very nice event. I think it was good for the community. We hosted last summer the Multiple Sclerosis Society Muck Ruckus, which was a mud run. That was a great event.
That was crazy. I watched
the Habitat
that.
Hobble's been out there. There's a host of things that happen yeah. out there. I mean, almost religiously annually, there's something once a month that happens
really?
Now in that meadow. Yeah, and that's been a really nice thing to be able to offer to people, to host events and things like that. The Grandkids Fall Fest has been there for several years.
What's that?
Grandkids is one of our early learning centers here in the Valley.
Okay.
And that's their biggest fundraiser.
Really?
It's every fall. Great, fun little event. It's a one-day event. And mm-hmm. And it does nice for them. Yeah. So it's always fun to have those kind of things going on at Grand Park.
Have you got a lot of things planned for this coming year?
We're working on a number of things this year. Again, starting some new homes. We've got some other products, Jerry, that we're working on. And of course, we talked about the commercial core a little bit earlier. So there's a lot of focus on what we're gonna be building next and what neighborhood we jump into next. And as far as amenities in the meadow there, we completed our trail system last year, the Loop Trail. That's almost a 4.5 mile loop mm-hmm. now.
I've been on that.
And I don't expect that we'll be doing much in the meadow this year, hay production. We still produce hay in the meadow.
Oh, really?
We do, yeah.
So you sell the hay?
We sell the hay. It goes to horses, cattlemen, all kinds of stuff like this. So
you don't have enough horses yourself to use it all?
No, unfortunately not. Or fortunately, maybe.
Fortunately.
Yeah.
Yeah, horses are an expensive hobby.
They are. So, but everything's going great.
Good.
Kind of moving ahead on multiple fronts. And of course, we're working on that Byers Peak Ranch development plan as well. And I'm moving ahead with that.
There's been a lot of talk about Byers Peak development.
Mm-hmm.
Why do you want it to be part of the town of Fraser rather than in the county?
Well, Grand Park's part of the town of Fraser.
Right.
Which is our largest investment in this area, and Fraser has struggles financially, which I think everybody is aware of. But our feeling is a stronger town ultimately benefits our larger investment in Grand Park. And Byers Peak Ranch, in our view, and knowing what we know about the town of Fraser, and its circumstances, and we've had lots of meetings, and I've dealt with them quite a lot, obviously, on a number of fronts.
Of course.
Byers Peak Ranch can address a lot of things that the town needs to have addressed.
Such as? And,
well, water's a very good example. The fee revenue from a project like Byers Peak Ranch is immense. We didn't calculate sales tax revenue, but...
What you mentioned fee revenue. What's well, included in that?
Fee revenue gets into building permit fees, planning fees, sewer tap fees, water tap fees,
okay.
Things like this. And in a full build-out scenario, Jerry, under the plan that's currently... with the town of Fraser, it's estimated to be around $53 million in revenue for the town. Now, maybe the project doesn't build out completely, but even if it builds out at 50%, it's a $26.5 million revenue generator for the town that they don't otherwise have.
How long do you really envision that taking based on, everyone knows there's been a real estate crash. It was in all the papers.
Yeah. It wasn't all the papers. I've experienced it firsthand. I think that that project is likely a 30 to 40 year build out, the complete project.
That's a long time.
And I base that off of our experience here thus far with Rendezvous, Grand Park, Leland Creek. This valley is not very developed and it has a long way to go.
Yes.
But things take a while. And so we'll probably have another downturn or two, I'm guessing, while we're developing this project. So it's going to be a while. It'll take some time. It's an interesting project in that we view it as an extension of Old Town Fraser and basing some more cost-effective, more affordable type housing there. And I would like to see more full-time residents living in the town of Fraser.
You really see it as an extension of Old Town. That's interesting.
I do, yeah. I call it inside the loop, the Fraser Valley Parkway being inside the loop. And coming off Mill Avenue, it's a really great fit for the town of Fraser with what we have envisioned. In fact, the architecture is not too unlike what we planned or what we're sitting in here. We're thinking of very salt box, historically mm-hmm. correct mm-hmm. Cousins Meadow type or Cousins Museum type building.
Right.
It's very simplistic in its form, but it's really functional.
Okay.
And it should allow us to keep our construction cost at a level that we can keep the price points low at Byers Peak Ranch. So that's part of the goal.
So you're trying to bring affordable housing into this?
Yeah, I mean, I deem it as cost effective, you know, reaching out to the middle class population and hopefully providing the opportunity for more full-time residents here. And we know we have a limited pool of jobs currently, and we're trying to grow the economy
right.
As a whole. And we have
Absolutely.
Ideas on how to do that, and they may differ from other people's ideas. But ultimately, this valley, in my view, and knowing the business owners that I know, we need more critical mass. We also need more draws in what I call core basic services, which in today's environment, most people have come to expect
right.
in their life in America. And so those are some of the things that you sacrifice today, but things that we think ultimately will come along
to invest
in the Fraser Valley.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thanks very much, Clark. We'll be back in just a couple of minutes. We're here today on Local Spotlight on TV18. I'm Jerry Nissen. I'm with Clark Lipscomb. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Local Spotlight on TV18. I'm here today with Clark Lipscomb. Good to have you, Clark. Clark, we were talking a little bit about economic development in the Valley. Where do you really see things going? What's your vision for this valley in the next years?
Well, my focus is clearly on the Fraser Winter Park area and the Upper Fraser Valley. And our goal is to grow the community, both in full-time residents, second home residents, and also hopefully creating an environment that attracts more visitors. like it or not, we compete with other resort towns in the Colorado Rocky Mountains. And I think in order to compete, you've got to look at what those towns are doing successfully and things that they've done that maybe haven't been successful.
Sure.
And try to emulate what is attracting the people and their dollars. And that's very important to this community. The economic growth here has been relatively non-existent, I think, as we all know. Doing projects like Mark Unicomb did with the Bowling Alley Theater is a great example. I think that has attracted more visitors. It's given local residents more to do.
No question.
And it's been an economic success. It's providing jobs. The more jobs that we can provide, the more full-time residents we can have, spending their dollars here 7 days a week. And I really think it's important that we focus as a community on how do we keep more dollars here locally. There's a lot of retail leakage, I'll call it, but there's a lot of dollars that go to the Front Range out of
this
community. And people tend to make those weekly trips. I'm probably guilty of it, and you're probably guilty of it.
I never leave the Valley.
But the bottom line is they make those because they can't get the types of things here that they need. And so that the bigger picture is if we can have a more well-rounded community that provides some of those, what I call the core basic services, the everyday needs type things,
yes,
then I think our economy will flourish and do better. And as we build those types of things, I think we attract more people to the community. You can look at a steamboat-like environment, and that's a pretty well-rounded town and a pretty solid economy over there.
You see Steamboat as a good model as opposed to an Aspen or a Vail?
Yeah,
or?
I think Steamboat, Breckenridge, those types of communities are probably more in keeping with what we're actually competing with when it comes to the visitors that come here, the tourists that come here, when it comes to the people that want to own a home here, be it whether they're full-time or second homeowners. I don't believe that we're competing with an Aspen or a Vail type environment, nor do I think this valley should have that type of character or even be able to kind of appeal to those people.
There are a lot of people in this valley that look at Vail, for example, and think of it as Disneyland, that it's a completely artificial environment. And Fraser is a much more organic environment. It's more natural. It's doesn't have that that showbiz side to it. We're much more down to earth.
Right. Well, I think you have to look at Vail is of course was developed from scratch and started in the 70s. And the Winter Park area started to develop in the 70s. And one of the things that I think present some challenges economically for the community is the stretched out nature of the two towns, being the town of Winter Park and town of Fraser, and the lineal suburbia strip-like development that occurred. It's what was in the 70s.
Right.
But it's not what the tourists want today, and it's not what a lot of the visitors that we hear from are expecting. They like that more core-like design and the more dense park your car and be able to stroll around. And a lot of it is about socializing. I mean, people come on vacation or they live in a place for social reasons. They want to see other people. There's some people that don't live in places for social reasons. They want to be by themselves.
Right.
I understand that.
And you see the Byers Peak development, for example, fitting into that model better. You mentioned before that you see it as an extension of Old Town Fraser,
I do.
Essentially.
Yeah, I think the Byers Peak model is, my hope is, it's the opportunity for a lot of the people that work at this end of the valley, but maybe they live down valley because of costs.
Okay.
To be able to locate right here in town. If we can succeed in that respect, then I think we've done very well. The risk is on us in these projects. I mean, maybe they succeed, maybe they don't. Maybe our vision's not the right idea. We feel like it is. We've done a lot of research, and we think it's important for the community to grow economically, socially, and I also think that we need a broader demographic base, a broader spectrum, in order to be a successful community. I don't think we can have kind of just one age group being representative of the community. I think it's really important to have a diverse group living here and residing here, and that ultimately makes our customer experience better. And hopefully attracts more people.
So not just lifties and retirees.
You know what? I was a lifty, and I had a great time as a lifty. Some days I wish I still was a lifty. I don't know that I'll ever be a retiree. I think you have to have families.
Right.
And we all know we've lost a lot of families during this economic downturn that we've gone through.
Mm-hmm.
And it's important to have families, to have younger children. It's important for our schools. It's important for our businesses here. That's what provides some stability in the economy, is having that broad spectrum.
Yeah. With the Byers Peak development, I know that water is a big issue that all of us locals talk about. There was a study by the Northwest Colorado Council of Governments, I think, a couple of years ago that said that as of 2003, all the water Fraser had was not even enough, really, to take the existing planned development of Fraser into the future. And with the Byers Peak development, obviously, there's quite a few more water taps coming online, mm-hmm. more homes, more businesses. How much water are you really bringing to the table with this project, and how much is needed?
Well, I'm not sure about the study that you're referencing, but as an example, the Rendezvous Grand Park project has its own independent water system that we have built, and it is sufficient for the entire build-out of Rendezvous and Grand Park. And then when you look at Old Town Fraser, there's not a lot of growth left in what is Old Town Fraser. The basket of water rights that the town of Fraser owns is significant. They have some very good water rights. They unfortunately don't have the capability of using them and putting them to beneficial use. They need water storage. And that's what Byers Peak Ranch provides. And the town has known this for a very long time. They need water augmentation storage, much like we built at Grand Park or here at this Rendezvous project. And that water storage will be satisfied through the Byers Peak Ranch project. It's almost $5 million in cost. And the town of Fraser today doesn't have $5 million to go spend building water storage, much less acquiring the land. So the Byers Peak Ranch, of course, would use a fair amount of that water storage itself, but it also provides a backstop to the existing town water services, the Old Town water services, with the storage.
Is it more a buffer storage, or is it actually bringing more water to the table?
Well, put it this way, the town manager said recently in one of the meetings, and was in his presentation, that they run the risk of their wells being turned off due to water calls. So they don't have the ability to store water and release it during the times that we have calls on the Fraser River. Okay, that's what it's about. It's about building water storage that they can store, and mm-hmm. when there's a call on the Fraser River, their wells can stay on and they release out of that pond. That's what a water augmentation pond does. So the commitment is 60 acre feet of water storage, which is a significant expense, and there's timing parameters in the agreement in terms of when we deliver it. There's one sooner, which does backstop the town sooner rather than later. And then there's one that's later on in the project and really isn't needed until Byers Peak starts building out, which is probably way in the future. So I'm guessing that the water will be developed.
So you think we're okay for a while?
Yeah, I think, I know the Grand Park Rendezvous system's okay. And I connected, the Grand Park project connected that water system to the town of Fraser that's providing redundancy to the town. And so the town of Fraser is fine.
Good. Hold that thought. We'll be back in just a minute with a final word with Clark Lipscomb. Welcome back. Here with Clark, we're talking about water and your developments.
So Byers Peak Ranch was what we were talking about in water for the town of Fraser and how the town of Fraser's water system works. And I'm by no means an expert on the town of Fraser's water system. We have lots of engineers and involved, and the town has its engineers and its water lawyers, of course. But the Byers Peak development plan provides the legal water rights. We give them to the town and then physically provide the storage that goes along with those legal water rights that we're providing to them for the storage. And that storage will allow the town that to then use the basket of water rights that it has today that it owns but can't fully utilize. Okay, and it'll allow for growth beyond the Byers Peak Ranch project for the town of Fraser.
It brings enough additional water in that it will, can be expansion beyond your project.
Yes, it will allow them to fully utilize all of their water rights. So they need physical improvements. They don't need more water rights. Their water rights are good.
So it's infrastructure rather than just more water access.
It is.
That Fraser really needs.
Yep, it's infrastructure. And funny enough, it's plant investment, and they have a plant investment fee or water tap fee. And there's a lot of people that say the town of Fraser is giving us these plant investment fees. That's just completely not true.
Really?
In fact, during our negotiations, I offered for them to keep all of them. Keep them all. And you guys go build the water storage and do the plant improvements. Of course, the risk then is on them.
Absolutely.
Because if I never build a house, they never get a tap fee. So instead, the agreement provides we go build it on the front end.
You build the facility first.
Using our money. And if I ever build a house, if we're successful, that first house would give us a tap fee, and the second one would give us a tap fee. So really the risk is on us. The town gets its water storage and the improvements that it needs for its water systems. And the success and whether we ever get the plant investment fee back is dependent upon our success as a developer. And I think that's something that a lot of people don't fully understand and grasp, that we are providing water rights to the town. And we're providing upfront dollars, effectively financing the town at our cost, that allow us to move forward with the development of Byers Peak Ranch. And ultimately, if we're successful, we'll get water tap fees reimbursed. The town shares in those fees, the way the project's written. So as things build out, there's splits in the agreement. But on an overall basis, it's a very, very good deal for the town of Fraser. And we'll solidify their water future.
Okay. Okay. You build a plant. You sell the homes. As you sell the homes, you get the tap fees to reimburse your investment in the plant,
right.
Essentially.
Well, right. And the storage is part of the plant.
Right.
Exactly. All right. So that's how it works.
Good. But,
so there's been a lot of effort spent on that by, like I said, the town's engineer and the town's water lawyers and those individuals in the negotiations of the agreement, which is, as I said, a very favorable deal to the town of Fraser, and all the risk is on the developer to spend the money on the front end. And unfortunately, in my business, there's no guaranteed successes.
Obviously.
As we all well know. But I really believe Byers Peak Ranch will prove to be a big success and help grow the community in a lot of positive ways.
Sounds like you've done a lot of planning, and your engineers are working on some of the challenging solutions.
We've been working on this for 6 years with the town, and the property zoned in the county to do virtually the same plan. And we have strong feelings as to why it should go into the town of Fraser and think it's good for the town of Fraser. But that there's been a lot of time, a lot of consultants, a lot of specialists that have worked on the project.
All right. Clark, we're getting near the end of our time together. What's really your final vision for the Valley and the whole Fraser community?
Well, I can't control what happens outside of our property, obviously. I would hope that we'll have positive influences on the Valley as a whole and on the town of Fraser and the town of Winter Park. as our projects progress. We're going to continue to focus on the things that we've been doing right and try not to make the mistakes that we've made in the past, and keep the project moving forward on the path that it's on. And my hope is ultimately it'll yield a greater community for everyone that lives here and makes a living here and visits here. That's what we all want.
Clark, thanks very much for being with us today. I'm Jerry Nissen. This has been Local Spotlight on TV18. Thanks for tuning in.